Good afternoon, and welcome to Interoperability Update, a webinar tweet chat from HealthSystemCIO. Just a little bit of housekeeping before we get started. My name is Anthony Guerra. I'm the editor-in-chief of HealthSystemCIO, and I will be your moderator today. We are having a simultaneous tweet chat hosted by Kate Gamble, our managing editor and director of social media. You can participate in a separate browser or on your phone by using the hashtag HSCIOChat, or you can simply view the tweet chat in the media viewer panel on the right-hand side of your screen. We're also going to use the polling panel later in today's event, so that should be fun for us to do. That'll automatically open when we launch our poll. And you could use the Q&A panel to submit questions or comments at any time. I'll leave the default set to all panelists, and we will take those later in the program. And you could download the deck by using the URL on your screen, and it's been sent out in the chat box. Just so you see how we're going to spend our time today, first we're going to go about 35 to 40 minutes with our featured panel discussion. And today we've got Dr. Chuck Jaffe, CEO of Health Level 7, HL7 International. Dr. Stephen Lane, Clinical Informatics Director for Privacy, Information Security, and Interoperability with Sutter Health. And Dr. Brett Oliver, CMIO at Baptist Health System of Kentucky and Indiana. So, without any further delay, we've got a lot of stuff to talk about today, so we are going to jump right in. Can you give us an overview of your organization and role? Chuck, let's start with you.
HL7 is a 35-year-old standards development organization. Our legacy standards enable exchange of data, about half of the world's healthcare data at any given time. 12 years ago, we began a program called Fresh Look, and 9 years ago introduced the FHIR platform, which today is about to be predicated in the ONC and CMS rulemaking, and I think we'll get to talk a lot about that in the coming hour.
Very good. Stephen?
Yes. Hi. My name is Stephen Lane. I'm a practicing family physician and clinical informaticist at Sutter Health. We are a large integrated healthcare organization in Northern California, where I serve as the clinical informatics director for privacy, information security, and interoperability. Our organization has been very bullish on the use of interoperability and trying to leverage data to support the care of our patients, both individually and at the population level. And I've worked with a really great team making that happen using standards-based exchange, query-based document exchange, direct messaging, increasingly using FHIR. So it's great to be here.
Excellent. Thank you, Stephen. Brett?
Hi, good afternoon. I am a practicing family physician like Stephen and Chief Medical Information Officer for Baptist Health. And we are a 9-hospital system, a little bit smaller than Stephen, across the state of Kentucky and southern Indiana, with about a 1,500-member employed medical group and 350-plus sites of care. We are not near as far along the continuum as a Sutter, but are really appreciating the value of interoperability and continuing to try to move that ball forward in our neck of the woods. And like Stephen, participate on the high-tech at a federal level and have enjoyed learning and contributing at that phase.
Excellent. Thank you, Brett. All right, a definition of interoperability. Number one, do we think it's important that we have a definition? Dr. John Halamka, you know, in our events has said, you know, some people say, oh, it's got to be every piece of data sent to anyone who wants it at any time, and that might be a little unnecessary and not even helpful. So let's talk about a definition as it can inform our discussion. Stephen, why don't you go first?
Sure. I mean, I think having common definitions is important. It allows people to work together to better define the scope of what they're trying to accomplish. I mean, I think we can look ahead to the idea of all data, available to appropriate users all the time without special effort. I think that's a great vision, and we might get there someday, but clearly there are specific definitions that have been written into law by our legislators, that have been developed by our organizations such as HIMSS and AMIA. But I think that having common definitions is critical in the work that Brett and I do with the federal HIT Advisory Committee. It's really important to be able to define what you're talking about, what data, by what means, for what users, for what purposes, because those are going to drive policy, and that in turn is going to drive the development of functionality by vendors, as well as the implementation of that functionality by clinicians and other stakeholders. So I think definitions are important.
Brett, definitions are important. Does it become a challenge, or is it the case that we have different entities coming up with different definitions, like HIMSS, like the government, different government bodies or groups or task forces? Do you find that? Is that becoming an issue, or is that a non-issue?
You know, I think it's an issue, but it really depends on what group you're talking to and who, you know, what's the potential, you know, use case and goal of that group. It's hard for me to get out of my clinician's mindset. I'm always just thinking about, you know, interoperability just at a very basic level. That's the ability of disparate systems or software to exchange information, but not just exchange it, make use of that information. And, you know, there's a lot of talk about exchanging data points, and I'll use something as silly as Fitbit data. Like, I don't want your Fitbit data as a patient. I don't know what to do with that.
Right.
Right? And yet that's celebrated as we've got interoperability now, and we can, through Epic, share your Fitbit data to your physician. I haven't, Stephen, you can certainly chime in, but I've not met a physician that really, at least right now, wants it or knows what to do with it and can stop at once. So I think it's really important to have the definitions. I agree, and the definitions that we talk about at a federal level in our committee work is certainly important, because you're talking about some legislative mandates. But when it comes down to it, it's just that ability to exchange the information and make use of the information. That second part is sometimes, you see a lot of organizations from Medicaid in my state and other places that want the data. They're not even sure what they're going to do with it yet. They just want it because it's interesting and they can play with it and move it around. From a patient care standpoint, and I'm not discounting that, certainly research and those kinds of use cases are super important. But when it comes down to, at least right now, I need to be able to make use of that information from the target audience.
And if you can't make use of it, you don't want it, because sometimes getting it brings with it responsibility to act on it, correct?
Precisely, yeah. What's my liability with that?
Right.
Can I chime in? Can I chime in just
Stephen,
in a brief
response? Then we'll go to Chuck.
Great. Yeah, I think, you know, that example of the Fitbit data or, you know, more generally patient-generated health data is very interesting, because it's true that we as clinicians don't really have workflows where we can ingest that data and meaningfully put it to use in the care of individual patients. I mean, I have patients that are connected with me, and I get their blood pressure, their home blood pressures online, and that's really cool, you know. And I have other patients that are connected, and I can see their home continuous glucose monitor data, and that's pretty remarkable. But the truth is, you know, we don't have time to really manage all that data. Having said that, making the data interoperable can serve other needs besides the needs of clinicians. The patients themselves being able to share that data with an app or a service provider that's providing online diabetes management or automated reminders to exercise more or less, or Apple Health identifying that you might be having atrial fibrillation. A lot of this goes beyond the needs of clinicians, and I think that while clinicians can clearly help identify where there is value to be gained through interoperability, there are other stakeholders that we need to keep in mind.
Chuck, thoughts?
Yeah, I took care of patients for 30 years, so I have a stake in this process. I think when you define interoperability, you mean for whom? We want to be able to share the kinds of data. And each of us has a different requirement for how that shared data is used. And I suspect that it would be quite different amongst the different care providers even. bottom line is that we need to first decide upon what goals we're trying to achieve. What are we trying to accomplish by interoperability? And I think then the statement of interoperability becomes less obtuse.
Very good. Thank you, Chuck. All right. Brett and Steven, talk about your work, the work of the ONC Core Data for Interoperability Task Force. What's the latest interoperability news on the policy front? Brett, why don't you go first?
Sure. I'll start. You know, just to review, our task force has kind of had two phases. Our first charge was back in early 2018, where we were asked to review the data elements that had been proposed, and we made recommendations about the approaches and mechanisms to receive feedback on data class priorities, and we commented on the proposed categories and how the USCDI would expand and by how much, and ultimately submitted a letter through our high tech in April of last year. And then when UNC crafted an actual data element promotion model, sort of how a data element is proposed and moves along the process to get adopted into the USCDI, that led into our task force's phase two. And over the last couple of months, we've been working on comments and recommendations on this proposed promotion model. For example, what does the submission cycle look like? They kind of, from the original, had sort of trimmed it down to three stages where you propose the elements, and there's a level one, level two, and then level three is actually part of the USCDI. And, you know, what's going on in each of those levels? What kind of pilot, what constitutes pilot testing? What constitutes a use case? How do you demonstrate evidence that it works? Is it an element that's already being captured? All those questions we're going through at each stage. Steven, do you want to add any more granularity to that? I don't know how deep we want to go into the specifics, but we're getting fairly close to submitting another letter back to, or at least meeting with our high tech in September on our recommendations.
Yeah, I think what I would add is just the central importance that seems to be focused on the U.S. core data for interoperability, that data set. What is included? What are the individual data elements that stakeholders, vendors, health IT solutions will need to be able to exchange? And the USCDI is really being built, you know, on the shoulders of pre-existing core data sets that have been named in prior regulation and is being advanced with the addition of new data elements such as patient demographics, data provenance, clinical notes that have really been identified as critical to stakeholders in the healthcare industry to be able to be exchanged. So I think that once we get through this process of finalizing what is going to be in USCDI version one, what's the level of granularity and the standards to support each of the data elements, and then what's going to be this promotion model where new items can be fed into the USCDI and can work their way up and be added. I think then the real excitement begins, because then we're going to get to see what stakeholders bring forward and propose for addition and what can be added and how quickly. I think, again, if our ultimate goal is all the data all the time, you know, there's a long stretch between what's been proposed for USCDI version one and, quote, all the data. And how we're going to traverse that gap, what's going to be added, when, and how quickly, that's going to really drive interoperability, especially because CMS and ONC are pointing to USCDI in their rulemaking.
And I would add, one of the most neat things that I've seen is that we've really discussed the necessity of a transparent process, as this will be new. That when decisions are made on a data element, everyone can understand how that decision was made so we can all learn from it and move things forward more quickly, to Stephen's point.
And the other thing we've spent a bit of time talking about is how to assure that not the data elements that have a small or perhaps not so well-funded constituency, where they're, you know, public health, for example, has data that needs to be exchanged. And how do we bring those things forward that don't have a big vendor or a lot of money pushing them forward through the process?
Very good. All right, Stephen, let's stick with you here. Can you update us on the work of the Interoperability Standards Priorities Task Force?
Yeah, so these are each task forces that were called for under the 21st Century Cures Act. And there's a integration between the work of USCDI, which defines the individual data elements, and the Interoperability Standards Priorities Task Force, which is looking at what are the standards that support key data exchange use cases. So our task force has been going for a bit more than a year now, I think, and have really focused in on what were felt to be key areas of exchange where there were opportunities to improve the granularity and the utility of data exchange. So we looked at orders and results. We looked at care coordination and closed loop referral management. And we're just finishing up a deep dive into data required for medication and pharmacy exchange. And we're going to be producing a report before the end of the year and sending that back to the HITAC and up to ONC. But the idea is to look for opportunities where standards can be advanced, can be developed, can be implemented differently to push forward. And then there are items that really overlap between the USCDI task force and the standards task force, and we're working those together across the different task forces. The other task force that's key is the one that drives towards what are the standards for the certification of health IT products, because the products then have to be able to manage the data using the standards. So all this work fits together, and that's what the ONC is trying to help push forward.
Very good. All right, Chuck, can you give us an update on HL7's work? What do you want CIOs to know about the organization's recent achievements and trajectory, and then a little bit about the Fire Accelerator program and some of the other things that we know you have going on over there with the CDS hooks and bulk data on fire?
I think it's important that the fire trajectory is well documented in a roadmap, which is clearly published on the HL7 website. So you can see what the goals are and what the expected outcomes of those goals. I think the publication of release 4, which was quietly done in December of last year, really culminated in ANSI's approval of it as a backward compatible stable standard, now supported by all the major EHR vendors and probably defined in the rulemaking that'll come out in October. To that end, there are a host of supporting technologies, including the bulk data initiative, which the implementation guide for bulk data will be released possibly this week or early next week. And it has now been publicly supported by the big six health cloud vendors, IBM, Google, Microsoft, Salesforce, Amazon Web Services, and Oracle, that they will use the bulk data and the Fire Exchange platform for sharing data between their clouds. The CDS Hooks initiative, which is my personal favorite because, as Steve mentioned, there are workflow challenges that electronic health records really don't support. So we have two options: change the way clinicians offer care to patients, which is one realistic approach, or change the way we provide them with information when they care for the patients. My guess is that an amalgam of those two approaches will take place. Next is a really ambitious program called the Fire Accelerator Program, which enables integrated solutions that have specific use cases to be advanced through the HL7 process to produce artifacts, implementation guides, specific profiles, and the like. Certainly, Argonaut was the first. Da Vinci, a much more recent example, which connects the payers and providers and really has an ambitious holy grail of delivering prior authorization to physicians. But there are a host of other organizations and entities. Now the group called Gravity that supports social determinants of healthcare, Codex program, which is a consortium of oncology groups, an ambitious program around public health, and even an effort by the AMA to support clinicians in healthcare. So as that emerges, I think there'll be more and more opportunities for unique use cases to be enabled, as well as consortia of groups that support these programs. I'm looking forward to the Connectathon in September in Atlanta, in which a lot of these capabilities will be tested, not only in the FHIR community, but between communities of providers, payers, and government agencies.
Excellent. Thank you, Chuck. Thanks for the update. Brett, let's start with you on this. What types of interoperability work are your organization doing today? And what are some of your recent achievements and future goals?
Well, we're an Epic shop, so we're live with Care Everywhere and sort of their interoperability platform, one of the earlier adopters on a lot of their parts of Happy Together, which brings together some other member organizations. We're connected to Care Quality, to those health information networks. We're actually just reached out to Stephen not too long ago to have a discussion. We're trying to determine if Health Exchange, which has sort of been in our queue for a while, is our future or not. The federal agencies, including SSA, plan to supplement their eHealth Exchange data by connecting with Care Quality. And so we're looking right now with our current sort of operational folks to see what gaps they have and to see if it still makes sense for us to proceed with the eHealth Exchange. You know, our biggest challenge right now, honestly, is some of our CIN, our integrated network. We've got so many disparate EMRs, and it really has hammered home to me the importance of the upfront contracting and sort of level setting on the front end and having your IT interoperability folks sort of at the table. Unfortunately, sometimes relationships get established and essentially, you know, promises made that you can't come through with because that level of interoperability doesn't exist. But that's kind of a snapshot of where we are right now.
Stephen?
Yeah. Well, we at Sutter Health have really been attempting over the last 10 years of our interoperability journey to leverage external data as much as possible. Our initial focus was really on the volume of data exchange and building that through creating connections with other organizations, through lowering the barriers to exchange. But now we've really kind of stabilized our organization. We exchange about 4 million documents a month across the many, many external organizations that with which we share our patients. And that's, you know, fully a 20% or so of the volume of exchange that happens statewide. So we're very much on the forefront of that. We've, you know, really, as I mentioned earlier, leveraged query-based document exchange, and we're trying now to really move from a focus on the volume of exchange to really deriving value from that exchange. So we recently did a lot of the work necessary so that our clinicians, when they're seeing patients, not only do they have access to external data, but that external data is brought directly into their workflow. And part of that includes the ability to see a longitudinal record of where the patient has received care and what that care was, regardless of whether it was in our organization or outside our organization, but also the integration of discrete data, for example, laboratory results. where if a laboratory result was done in another system across town or across the country, we can now see that directly integrated visually with the results that we've generated internally. When we're talking about care gaps, knowing when a patient has had their last mammogram or pap smear or colonoscopy or flu shot, if those procedures were performed externally, that data is automatically brought forward, and the alerts that we present to clinicians and then also to patients through the patient portal are now being informed by the full collection of data that we have available to us. So that's very exciting, moving towards really utilizing that data in addition to simply exchanging it. We've also been very successful in the utilization of direct interoperability and direct push messaging, and we're using that now for referrals across organizations. While ours is an integrated health system, we're also an open system. So we interact with a lot of providers in the community, and we receive referrals from folks from all over. And now we've been trying to, you know, as part of the Axe the Fax campaign, trying to move referrals from the fax machine into direct interoperability so that actual discrete data is being exchanged from the referring provider to the consultant and then back again with the closing of that loop. So that's been very successful for us. And then the other thing really is cross-vendor exchange. Like Brett, we utilize the Epic EHR, and it's generally easier to exchange data when you're exchanging with someone using the same vendor, you know, when the same vendor owns both ends of the discussion. But when you're crossing vendors, it gets more complicated. And that's where the work of the eHealth Exchange, Commonwell, you know, and now the Care Quality Framework that allows those networks to exchange across each other is really becoming more and more important. And literally just this morning, I was working with one of our analysts, and we are now able to exchange EKG tracings from another system in our community that's using a Cerner EHR, and we can now ingest those into our Epic EHR and display them to our users. That's been very difficult to do historically, and there's just been a lot of work on the standards and their implementation by the vendors that's now making that possible. And that kind of granular data exchange can really improve the safety, the quality, and the cost effectiveness of the care we provide.
Very good. All right, Stephen, let's stick with you on this one. Can you talk a bit about the state of payer-provider data exchange and the role of the DaVinci project?
Well, I can. It's very interesting that we've made so much progress on provider-provider exchange over the last 10 years, exchange for the purpose of treatment. There are lower and lower barriers to that. But when you talk about exchanging data between providers and payers, suddenly people get very anxious because it's an interesting relationship. On the one hand, payers and providers are very much aligned and wanting to provide high-quality, cost-effective care. You know, on the other hand, there's a certain bit of a adversarial business relationship where there's at least an experience of a fixed pie, you know, and if one diner gets a bigger piece of the pie, the other one might get a smaller piece. So I think there's a lot of sensitivity, and there are a lot of different use cases, whether you're talking about treatment, where you have folks working for a payer that are doing care management and are actually involved in taking care of patients, whether you're talking about a risk adjustment, whether you're talking about the need to report on quality metrics, to manage prior authorization. There's many, many use cases. And the folks at DaVinci, and Chuck can speak more about this, he's been very involved in promoting DaVinci. The folks that are involved, whether they're payers, providers, technology companies, or HL7, have really focused in on defining what are the key use cases for payer-provider exchange, what data needs to be exchanged, in what workflows, and then building specific implementation guides that will support that exchange. So, you know, we in our organization have been involved in informing that process. are still in the process of trying to get up and running with our first pilot, but I think that the bi-directional exchange of data for specific purposes between payers and providers really holds the promise to make healthcare both more efficient and more cost-effective.
Chuck, did you want to add anything about the Da Vinci project?
Yes. I think it grew out of an initiative we had at HL7 called the Partners in Interoperability. The payers came to the table excited about the opportunity of collaborating with providers. And I think this spurred a host of different discussions at this level. One of the challenges that's going to exist with Da Vinci or any other program is the quid pro quo. As providers share more and more data with the payers, comes the question of what's in it for them. I think that'll be a never-ending debate. It will be incumbent on the payers to clearly articulate that there are some analytics, risk-based assumptions, models that emerge from this that they need to share with the providers, because that's going to be the key to better care. And I think over the coming months, we'll see a lot of discussion to support payer contribution to the clinical knowledge base.
Very good. Excellent. All right. Brett.
Can I add to that,
yeah,
Anthony?
Go ahead.
Sorry, before
sure.
we leave that. I
sure.
think one of the challenges that we have is that the Da Vinci workflows are really based on FHIR as the mechanism and the structure of the content that's being exchanged. And I think that a lot of the provider organizations are starting to get more familiar with FHIR. They've been required to make clinical data available to patients using FHIR, and that has really been rolling out increasingly. But this is a different kind of an exchange with a different sort of data, different use cases, and I think that unlike patient data access via FHIR, this provider to payer data access via FHIR is not yet required by regulation. So what we see is that the HIT vendors, the EHR vendors in particular, are just starting to gear up to be able to support these kinds of exchanges. And it's one thing to have a payer query a provider for quality metrics. It's a very different thing for the provider to query the payer and to be able to bring claims or other data in from the payer and then integrate it into the clinical workflow. We know pretty well how to integrate that into, say, a data warehouse and use it for analytics, but how to get that all the way into the point of care is a whole new challenge and one that I think we're really going to face as this moves forward. And we were talking about it before the call actually started. Now CMS has stepped into the fray, offering the notion of being able to access claims data from CMS for Medicare beneficiaries and then be able to bring that into the process of care directly. And I think that that's going to really help to accelerate this discussion of how well the EMR vendors are able to ingest and utilize that data.
Very good. Excellent. Brett, let's go with you on this. What would a interoperability discussion be without talking about information blocking? So what role should vendors play in fostering interoperability? Are they doing it? Is there information blocking going on? And if so, how can it be stopped? Your thoughts?
All in 30 seconds, right, Anthony?
That's all you got, buddy. Just kidding.
You know,
take your time.
The vendors, no, that's good. I'll make it 29. Of all the vendors, you know, that I seem to come in contact with, and as mentioned, we're an Epic shop, and then all of the third parties. You know, I have not really seen outright information blocking. From a clinical perspective, what I see more of is sort of an information delay, is how I would term it. You know, we're in the clinical world, we're used to sharing of patient data. However, you know, often the delay, not blocking, but the delay is costly. If the other facility that you query for, let's say you have a patient in the emergency room that has some abdominal complaints, you know they've had an abdominal CT scan, you know, 2 days prior at another facility, you know, we have processes in place to request that information. But sometimes if that process leads to a delay and we go ahead and just order the CT scan again because the patient care, you know, trumps waiting on that information. So with better interoperability, systems that where that CT scan is available at the point of care without any manual involvement, you know, that's really where I see most of the clinical, you know, delay / blocking happening. Casper, our PDMP in the state of Kentucky, is another example. You know, we're required by law to query it, and there are all kinds of use cases for it. But it takes an extra step. Their system could be delayed, and again, it's interoperable and it's not blocking. They provide it, but is that sufficient enough? Is that delay end up costing patient care issues, cost, quality of care, et cetera? But I'd be curious to hear from Stephen and Chuck, who have a longer history in this realm, kind of what their experience is. I know it happens. I've read the examples, you know, in the press and in the literature, but I don't see it at a clinical level. I see the vendors playing along, seeing that the government's serious, particularly when you have $1 million penalties to things, and it seems to be melting away if it existed.
Chuck?
Yeah, I wouldn't characterize it as playing along. I think it's fundamental to their business model. I think it accentuates their capabilities when Epic and Cerner can exchange data. In fact, there are some millions of records exchanged daily between Cerner-based organizations and those serviced by Epic. So the fact that it's done at a technical level is hardly a reality. We have challenges to workflow, to misconceptions about HIPAA, and my greatest bugaboo, which is patient identification. I think as we move toward a reality that the failure to identify patients accurately costs lives, the government will change its mindset about a patient identifier. And I think that's really critical if we're going to be successful in reducing costs and improving care quality.
Well, we did get an audience question, someone asking to hear any words of wisdom about patient matching and how it's being managed. So first off, I could tell you we do have a webinar in a couple of weeks coming up on patient matching, so register for that after the event. But anything you want to touch on about patient matching, Stephen?
Yeah, I'd love to. Patient matching, I think, is really critical, and it is, in some sense, it can be seen as falling under the umbrella of information blocking. Insofar as if you've got vendors and their patient matching algorithms or logic is not up to snuff and you can't match your patients, then you can't get the data. So you are functionally blocked from getting that. And we experience that when we exchange across vendors, where we see that exchange in one direction relies on the patient matching algorithm of the queried system. An exchange in the other direction may rely on the patient matching algorithm of the other system, and we see a mismatch. I often can receive data from an organization where they utilize the matching algorithm of my HR vendor, and the data makes it all the way through to me in real time, and there it is. And then I turn around and I query that same organization to get additional data, and they will tell me no patient found. So even though I know the patient was seen there, I can't get back into the source organization because their matching algorithm is using a different logic. So I think you have a question later on about, you know, how important is a universal patient identifier. I think it would be a game changer. There's a lot of heat being generated by these challenges in patient matching, and if we could just hop over that and know that if another system has seen the same patient, that we can exchange data about that patient, that's going to make a big difference.
Brett, anything on patient matching?
It's a big lift. You know, it'd be a brand new data element. My question just out to this group as well as to anybody else is, what do we do about the historical data? Is it just we would patient match from today forward once we rolled something out like that? Because you're talking about a brand new, essentially, data element that would have to be included in every single component of health IT software. I agree. I think it's critical to be moving forward, but it's pretty complex.
Yep.
I think
pretty
complex is worth the cost.
Oh, I'm not disagreeing with you at all, Chuck.
All right. Very good.
You had another question, Anthony. Anthony, you passed over me on the information blocking question more generally.
Go ahead.
But I did want to share an experience. So, as mentioned, you know, our vendor, Epic, happens to support 40 of the largest healthcare systems in our state, and we have developed a community of users where we've worked together to lower barriers to information exchange, both within and without our community. And one of the initial focuses of our effort was on removing unnecessary requirements for patient authorization. And we just recently, across our state, achieved, after 10 years of working toward it, getting to the point where none of the participating organizations require a patient authorization to exchange data unnecessarily. Clearly, such authorizations are required for certain types of behavioral health and substance abuse data, but we really achieved a tremendous milestone when organizations stopped requiring it just routinely for exchange of data. And to me, that was one of the first and largest information blocking hurdles that we had to get over, because collecting that authorization from the patient requires that the patient be in front of you. It requires a lot of steps that became a tremendous impediment to accessing data at the point of care in real time. And I actually went back to DC and spoke to the people who wrote the information blocking regulations and explained this problem that we were having. And I think it's pretty clear in the current draft rules related to information blocking that won't be allowed, that people sort of willy-nilly requiring patient authorization. The other big lift that we've been working on is what's called open notes, allowing patients to have direct access to clinical notes online. There are folks who would say that people who withhold clinical notes from patients are information blocking. And here again, I think in the proposed rules that are out there, it looks like that's probably going to be expected, that patients will have direct access to their notes. So I think that there are a lot of examples of information blocking that we can find. And I think having the finalization of the rules, hopefully, later this year, we'll see, will be welcome so that people can really understand what data needs to be able to flow in what situations.
Very good. All right. We're going to open our poll, and what we're doing here is kind of interesting. So the answer for these statements is either agree or over the top, and you get to pick. So we're making some statements here, and you get to pick. That poll is open, so start working on it right now, and we'll be discussing it with our panelists. So, first point, the government blew a huge opportunity by not baking interoperability into the meaningful use program. Agree or over the top? Chuck, this one's for you.
I think it was a different time, a different era. I think there was an opportunity they missed, but I wouldn't call it blowing the opportunity. I think they weighed the options and they came up short. I disagree, but I can relate to the people who chose the path they took.
All right, very good. The majority of healthcare IT vendors are focused primarily on maximizing revenue and therefore not fostering interoperability as much as they could. Stephen, agree or over the top?
No, I have close relations with many of the health IT vendors, especially their interoperability teams. And I can say that to a person, they are committed to serving the needs of patients, providers, and other stakeholders. I really don't subscribe to this notion that they're a bunch of money grubbers. I mean, people who want to make a lot of money can make it in other ways besides health IT, that's for sure. I think that the vendors are in line with us. I mean, they clearly need to keep the lights on and support their customers, but I don't think that their financial interest is getting in the way of their engagement in interoperability.
Okay. Brett, last one's for you. The only way to truly solve the patient identification problem is with a national patient identifier.
I would go with over the top. I think it's critical and I would support it, but I think it could be done without it. Using sort of non-demographic mechanisms for identification, whether it's biometrics, smartphone technology, better algorithms. I mean, it's exciting. The technology is rapidly becoming available on commodity devices. But anyway, I guess the bottom line is I think it's over the top. It's not the only way. I would support it, but I don't think it's the only way.
All right.
Can I comment on that, Anthony?
Go ahead, please. Go ahead, Chuck.
Yeah. There's a difference between the only way and the best way. We certainly have improved matching algorithms, using publicly available databases, using cell phone technology, et cetera. One of the shortcomings of that is the tremendously underserved population who don't have those tools available to them, or the individuals who are not conscious and able to reply to queries like, do you currently have a late model Ford registered? So, while all those technologies get us closer to patient matching, I don't think they achieve the goal that we had hoped for.
All right, very good. So we're going to share the poll results, and we see that the government, as far as the government, blew a huge opportunity by not baking interoperability into the meaningful use program. 69% agree with that statement. 23% say it's over the top. The majority of healthcare IT vendors are focused primarily on maximizing revenue and they're therefore not fostering interoperability as much as they could. 62% agree, 23% over the top. And the only way to truly solve patient identification is with a national patient identifier. Again, 62 agree, 23% over the top. So, some interesting answers there. I want to jump to our Ask a Co-Panelist question, see what you gentlemen would like to learn from each other. So, Brett, let me put you out there first. Do you have a question for either or both of your co-panelists?
Yeah, both, and it's kind of a general question, but you guys have been around the block with interoperability longer than I have, and, you know, I see an administration, both the current one and the one before, that's very serious and seems to be moving at a pace that's pretty quick, and an industry that seems poised to move the needle of interoperability quickly. My question is, am I naive? Have you all been down this road before only to be disappointed?
Chuck, why don't you jump in?
I don't think it's fair to say that we've been down the road before. Certainly, we've tried other approaches to this. I think the current approach that we're embracing and the trajectory will solve problems and get to solutions faster than we ever had before.
Stephen?
Yeah, I feel that we are part of an iterative process, that the work that's been done in the past has really laid the foundation that's allowing us to move forward. I was particularly struck by your question about blowing an opportunity with meaningful use. I mean, meaningful use is what got computers into the hospital room and into the exam room. It did require the ability to interoperate, you know, MU2 and the ability to send messages at times of transitions of care. I mean, not everyone has implemented that broadly, but the technology exists to do that. So I think that, you know, we are building and moving down a path. We've made tremendous strides, you know, with document-based exchange. We are really at the dawn of fire-based exchange, and there's naturally going to be something that comes next, but at this point there's so much energy and enthusiasm being put into fire, different stakeholders coming forward. Chuck mentioned social determinants of health, so new data elements, new methods of exchange. I think that we're at the dawn of a real renaissance in healthcare and in medicine, insofar as we're going to have access to larger and higher quality data sets. Those data will be able to move around to support clinical research, to support population health management, to support public health in ways that people are just beginning to imagine.
Chuck, did you have a question for your co-panelists?
I'll pass. I was going to ask my colleagues about a patient identifier, so I'll hand off to Stephen or Brett.
All right, Stephen?
Yeah, so I mentioned a little earlier the data at the point of care announcement that was made by CMS last week, that they are going to be making Medicare claims data available for providers to download and integrate into workflows to impact the care that we provide to patients. I'm personally very enthusiastic about that. You know, we've talked about claims data and its value for interoperability. It's moved around today for certain purposes, mostly for analytics, et cetera, but really trying to make that clinically relevant and utilize that other source of data in addition to clinical data, pharmacy data, lab data, et cetera. And I'm just curious to ask, you know, either Chuck how he thinks that is going to impact our movement towards data liquidity, and to Brett as to whether he and his organization are looking to leverage that offer from CMS to help us move this forward.
Chuck?
Yeah, I think every action that's taken moves the needle a little bit closer. I view interoperability as a journey, not as a destination. I don't think we'll have one definitive solution. I think the government offers a possibility. I think there are more government actions coming in this year alone that will move the needle. I hope that there is a coalescence of public and private sector programs that get us even closer to achieving it.
Very good. Brett, did you want to weigh in on that at all?
It's an exciting announcement. I love the thought of closing care gaps, et cetera, whether it's through our case managers, nurse navigators, or the physicians themselves. So being able to have a look into that longitudinal piece that the claims data can provide, I'm looking forward to that. We are not, we're just investigating whether or not we would be able to participate at this time.
Very good. I have one audience question I want to get to before we run. It's for Stephen. Can you speak more to the technology in use to ID gaps in care based on both internal and external data sources?
Yeah, we, again, we're an Epic shop, and Epic provides the functionality to allow externally sourced data to directly inform care gaps as they are displayed to the provider and or the patient. We also use registries, and the registry metrics, the logic of the registry metrics can be modified so that an externally received procedure, result component, immunization, diagnosis, vital sign, that data can be ingested and utilized in the logic that calculates whether a care gap is open or closed and how a registry metric is calculated.
All right, very good. Well, that's about all we had time for today. What a great discussion. We took the whole time and probably could have gone much longer. Regarding continuing education, those of you who hold the CHIME CHCIO certification get one CEU for attending our events. So let CHIME know you were here, and if you've asked us to do so, we certainly will. If you need a certificate of attendance for another CEU program, you can use the final slide in this deck. You'll receive an email when the on-demand recording of this event is ready. If you want to sponsor an event or book a custom event, you can go to our website or reach out to Nancy Wilcox from our team. And you can go to our website to view our upcoming schedule of events, including that patient identification one, which sounds like it may be of interest. I want to thank our speakers today, Dr. Chuck Jaffe, Dr. Stephen Lane, and Dr. Brett Oliver, very much for a great conversation. And I want to thank you, our attendees, for joining us. With that, everybody have a wonderful day. Thank you.
Thanks.